funny.
Yeah. Well, in a way, but in a way not. All right. So what we'll do today is I am going to, because I remember on Monday I asked you guys to think of a project to do for the rest of this semester. Yes? Okay. All right. So what I want to do is to kind of talk about a project that I have in mind, and I'm going to talk about, you know, how, you know, to kind of plan out for the project, how to kind of look at the project, and kind of track, you know, various aspects of a project. And in the way, you know, I also want to see if any one of you would be interested in this project, not for this class, but, you know, potentially, you know, just as an unpaid intern, you know, for Professor Schuster in his design tech lab. So it's going to be interesting. Okay. So what this is about is I'm using Dieselzilla Attack Drone, you know, as an example. So I need to give you a background, you know, like a context first before I talk about the app itself. So Dieselzilla is this thing here. And let me see if I can turn on the audio. I just have to switch the audio to the right channel. So output devices. And for some reason, it's always muting the one that I'm supposed to use. Okay, so start from the beginning. There we go. For a brief moment, I thought I was in a Harbor Freight, because this is the kind of music that they play all day long at Harbor Freight as you shop for hammers. Okay, so Dieselzilla is basically a gigantic statue. It has actuated arms, but otherwise it doesn't move at all. Okay, but the arms can move a little bit, has limited motion, which is based on hydraulics. So the whole idea is to have Dieselzilla in this year's state fair as an exhibit. Now, as a statue, you know, with just moving arms, it's not really that interesting. Okay, people look at it and go like, oh, okay, kind of cool, and then they just move on. So what we are doing, you know, as ARC, as a campus, is we want to invite high schools so that high school students can pilot their drones to attack Dieselzilla, and they will keep score. And then so they can have a competition, like, you know, who can hit all the spots, you know, the fastest, and so on and so forth. So this way, you know, it's not just a schedule, but we'll actually arrange, you know, competitions around it. Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right. So what you need to do is to kind of imagine, you know, Dieselzilla, okay? And I was able to draw in just a few strokes. Okay, that's close enough. So you just kind of imagine that, you know, Dieselzilla is, you know, in the center of something. And then you have drones, you know, flying around it, okay? So you have drone one and drone two flying around it. And they will be, quote unquote, firing, you know, at, you know, Dieselzilla, but they have to aim correctly as well. Is that okay? So the question is, you know, how do you know, you know, whether, you know, a shot has landed on Dieselzilla or not? How do you keep score? So at this point, it has nothing to do with apps, but at some point, it's gonna connect to apps. So the way I plan to do this is I will plant blinking LEDs, you know, on Dieselzilla. So, you know, at key places like the nose, maybe one inside the mouth, you know, two on the back, one in the, you know, torso, you know, one on the tail, and one right on top of the head, which is really hard to hit because drones cannot tilt. They can only fly in a level way unless they're accelerating. Okay? So these things are coordinated in a blinking way, so they blink in sequence. They don't blink all at once, but they blink in sequence. So the timing of the blink can be used to identify which LED a particular drone is looking at. So as a result, we can now say, okay, this particular target is taken care of, time to move on to the next one, the next one, the next one, the next one, the next one. So the competition is not about, find the drone in a very stable way and just point to the same spot and just, say, I'm firing at the same spot. They have to fly around the entire thing as quickly as possible and get all of these points. So that would make it a lot more interesting than just, staying at the same spot and just, say, fire, 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 fire. That would not be very interesting. So this way, it is forced to fly around. Okay, so the way this is arranged, you can use another color. Each drone has a camera, has a camera on it, an onboard camera. And the camera uses a very kind of really old technology, RF transmission, to broadcast the video feed. So the video feed is going into a receiver. The receiver outputs, NTSC, signal, which is really old. It's just a really old, video, signal standard. And that goes through a USB dongle, and then it attaches to either a laptop or a desktop computer, so that, the computer can do image processing. Is that okay? So this way, if the drone is looking into the mouth of Diesel Ziller, and the center of the video feed is indeed the LED, then it can be counted as a hit, but only if there's some kind of simulated firing mechanism, and a quote unquote shot is fired within a certain time frame of the LED blinking. Does that make any sense? Okay. So far there's no use of any type of app. The firing mechanism is where the app comes in handy. So, there will be one person doing the piloting, to line up, to the LED, but there will be a second person looking, over the shoulder of the video feed, and then determine when is a good time to press the button to simulate, the firing of the projectile. So, is that okay? So the app is the actual firing mechanism. So you can kind of imagine the app itself would look like this, okay? So depending on whether the person is left-handed or right-handed, or how you want to arrange the display and stuff like that, there'll definitely be a button, which is your main trigger. When you press the button, it will simulate firing a single shot. But I'm thinking about having a slider here too. So that's kind of your safety. So normally it is in a safe position. You have to flip it open before you can actually do the firing. And then it'll be selected up here. So you can have a single shot, a continuous shot, and also a burst, so you can you have a selector to help you manage your the use of quote unquote ammo. Is that okay? Sort of? Okay. So the person who's using the mobile is going to be quote unquote the gunner. And the gunner is basically going to look at the video feed and determine what to use over here and also when to press the button. And then on the same screen, there will be a ammo count. So they're only allowed a certain number of shots. And if they run out, then I'm sorry, that's the end of that particular session, because no more shots can be fired at that point. And they cannot crash the drone onto Diesel Ziller either.
No kamikaze.
No kamikaze, kaze, because it's Japanese.
Yeah,
kamikaze. Which literally means God wind, or sacred wind. Does anyone know how that term comes around? Kamikaze? There were like two attempts of foreigners trying to invade Japan, and then each one, a natural disaster in the form of a storm, deterred or stopped the invasion. So the Japanese people, or some of them, believe that they were protected by some kind of deity. So if anything bad is about to happen, the sacred being will intervene by doing all kinds of natural things. So in World War II, kamikaze is referring to the suicidal pilots who would crash their airplanes onto the ships to try to sink the ships. So but they coined that term because they are protecting the mainland or protecting the island of Japan. So anyhow, so this is the app. So the app is this thing over here, and you know, the question is, how do I design an app like that? What is involved, and you know, what type of analysis do we have to go through when we design an app like that? Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So I got the notes already done. Okay. So that just explained what is DieselZilla and the whole project. The whole project itself is DAD. I just coined its term, you know, DieselZilla attack drone or drone swarm or whatever you want to call that. It's not going to be a real swarm because the idea of having a swarm is actually kind of dangerous, because just imagine a whole swarm, like three or four of these drones, you know, flying around, you know, the statue. The statue is not really that big. We're not talking about a gigantic statue where you have, you know, three or four drones and there's no way they can be even close to each other. The drone is, you know, probably about twice the size of this, you know, cabinet, twice as tall, twice as wide, and twice as long. Okay, I would say that's about the right kind of magnitude. It's not that big. If you have three or four drones, you know, trying to compete for the same spots, they will crash into each other. And we are talking about, you know, this is being in a state fair as an exhibit. There'll be a lot of people around, and two drones colliding will basically shatter the blades, which are rotating at really high speed and sending the shards of the blade in every single direction. That may not be very, you know, child friendly. And then don't forget, you know, when the drone loses one, you know, propeller, it's not going to be balanced anymore. So the whole thing is just like in any science fiction. You know, the whole thing is going to crash down, and that may not be very safe either from the bystander's perspective. So we don't want collision. We don't want mid-air collisions. So we'll probably have only up to two or three drones at the most to handle for each, you know, competition. Two works out really well because then you can use a tournament, you know, scheme to decide who is the champion of the day, of that particular day. Is that okay so far? So this whole project is separated into multiple components, and I'm just you know, doing this to try to make the window fit, because the left edge is not visible from your perspective. So I'm just trying to get it so that it wraps around like that and position it just right so that we can see the entire thing. There we go. Okay. So the first component is the LED controller, which is not really exactly app related. It's just, you know, how do we control the blinking of the LEDs. So I'm going to skip that section because it doesn't apply to this class. But if you're interested, you can certainly, you know, take a look at it. The other component is called a video feed analyzer, which is a program running in the laptop, on the laptop computer. And all it does is to analyze the video feed coming back from the drone and also match the timing of the video feed with the LED blinking so that we can identify, okay, is which LED are we seeing and is it at the center of the image. But it doesn't actually do any type of conical shot or, you know, fire control. There'll be a scoreboard program. The scoreboard program, the way I envision this, is going to be web-based. So anyone who wants to look at the status of a particular match can just log into a website, or not even log in, just go to a particular URL, and, you know, the update of the scores will be updated on the web page as well. So that's going to be it. It's going to be an easy one to do, you know, with some PHP scripting and the database, you know, backend. That should be doable, you know, without a whole lot of effort. There will be a coordinator program on the laptop. So the coordinator program is going to coordinate all the components: the LED blinking, the scoreboard, and also the firing control, and also the video analyzer. And what is going to relate to this particular class is the fire control app. In other words, the user interface, you know, and also the program that is running on the mobile device is, you know, what this class is, what is relating to this class, because that's a mobile app. Is that okay so far? Okay. So just like, you know, with any app that we are going to write, we first have to identify, you know, what is the value, what is the purpose of this app, why is somebody, you know, installing this app? Well, it's kind of clear why we are doing this, because in this case, the value of the firing app, the fire control app, is to enable the whole demonstration. Because without this app here, there's no way to control, quote unquote, the firing of the drone onto this auxiliary, and so it's not going to be as much fun. I mean, you can still fly around this auxiliary, but without a count, without the competition, without the simulation that you're attacking this auxiliary, the whole entertainment value of DAD, this auxiliary attack drone, is just going down the toilet, because it's not going to be nearly as much fun. Is that okay? Because you can just put some cones in the middle of a parking lot and just fly a drone around the cone, and that doesn't seem very entertaining to me. Yes?
Yeah.
Well, if you ask people who do autocrossing, they will tell you something entirely different, because they like to spin their little cars around cones all day long and call it fun. I used to be one of those people. Especially when your back end starts sliding, that's a lot of fun.
Have you seen the indoor drone racing?
No.
Pretty cool. They've got cameras on the drones and they race them around like
a track.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That would be kind of fun. But this one is attacking something too. So you have you need a more precise aiming, because you need to fly and kind of you can either strafe, you can have different strategies, right? So it's all between the pilot and the gunner. If the gunner says, okay, I need you to be completely stable on its target, and then once you're on target and I'll fire, then you can work it out that way. On the other hand, if your gunner is really good, the gunner can coordinate with the pilot and just fly across the target point, and I'll strafe, and I'll do fire control at the right time to get it. So you don't even have to stop. You just have to kind of, go around it, still in motion, and I'll be able to handle that. So there will be other, various strategies. The DAD demonstration in return has a value of entertainment and drone pilot, training. Of course, these days, drone pilot training is really not going to be needed much longer, because most drones will be fully automated. Just like cars, just ask Uber, which recently got into some pretty hot water because of their autonomous cars. Did any one of you check it out, how Uber got into some pretty hot water recently?
Yeah, I read
in
about
multiple
it.
Ways?
I
okay.
read about the Google lawsuit. And then also, their workplace policy stuff.
Yeah, workplace policy, because according to some female employees, the workplace is very hostile to female workers. There's a lot of sexism in the company, in the workplace. So that's one. Number two is their head engineer, right? One of their head engineers was a Google employee, but when he got on board of Uber, he did not disclose that his resignation from Google was a disputed one. So there's a dispute over his resignation over at Google, and now Google is, it's basically, I guess they're accusing Uber of stealing trade secrets. And then the third one had to do with a lot of the tests of their autonomous vehicle was actually illegal. They never got permission to do it. So I think in the process of trying to push forward, Uber, probably, is going to have to step backwards a few times, to move forward again because of all of these issues.
Did you get permission from the city?
I do not know, but I.
They didn't have a DMV, California DMV approval for self-autonomous car.
Okay. So there you go. California DMV calls Uber's autonomous auto illegal, but they did it anyway. They knew that it would be viewed as illegal, but they did it anyway. So that's kind of get them into some serious trouble there.
One of those cars ran a red light too.
Well, not that people do not run red lights. But when people run red lights, they're only certain people, right? But if you imagine the whole street is filled with Uber autonomous cars and they all have the same bugs, they will all be running red lights at the same time. That may not be very pleasant, especially if you're a pedestrian.
Who gets the ticket?
Hmm?
Who gets the ticket?
Oh, it's going to be Uber. I mean, Uber is going to get sued, and they will have to pay the fine. I would imagine that's only one responsible party in this case, because the people in the vehicle, they have no control over the vehicle to begin with. So there's no way you can actually blame the people who are in the vehicle. I mean, if anything, they're victims too, because if there's a collision or there's a traffic jam as a result, you know, the passengers inside the car are traumatized, and they're just as much as a victim as, you know, people who are outside of the vehicle. So, you know, if you haven't read it, you know, go ahead and read this article. It's kind of interesting because Uber started off with, you know, just, you know, have it being a connection service between people who are driving and people who need to get a ride from point A to point B. But they got on board the autonomous vehicle thing like that. And they were pushing really hard to. I actually know a person, you know, this is a family friend's, you know, son, and he is actually currently working for Uber on that autonomous vehicle project. So I can try to ask him for some insider information. Like, when should I sell your Uber stock?
Yeah.
So anyway, interesting stuff, you know, how a company went from just, you know, writing apps to connect, you know, drivers and people who need a ride all the way to, you know, fully autonomous vehicles. Their most ambitious plan is actually not taxis. They are working on big rigs as well. So we are talking about 18-wheelers, you know, because that's where most of the money is if you can automate 18-wheelers, okay? The kind of saving that you can materialize is actually tremendous. Just think about, you know, all the money they have to pay for people to drive 18-wheelers. They can only drive 18 hours a day. I mean, that's like you're really pushing it. But with autonomous vehicles, say for, you know, maintenance and refueling and stuff like that, they can be on the road 24/7.
All you have to do is hack the grid and look at all those autonomous
weapons.
Massive trucks driving down the road.
Yep. Yep, and you can just kind of, you can imagine the importance of security when you have, you know, everything fully autonomous on the road.
It's got to, I think we have to move into verifiable code. We'll be really open that.
And imagine, you know, 18-wheelers who are, that they are transporting fuel.
They're just weapons.
There's a movie called Maximum Overdrive.
Uh-huh.
Stephen King story where all the trucks become alive.
Uh-huh.
And start attacking people.
Well, you can also imagine just, you know, a hostile organization, you know, just wants to cause you problems. You know, they don't need to invest in any weapon on their own. They just need to find out how to hack into the system. Then they can use these autonomous vehicles to do all kinds of bad stuff.
They've been taking control of cars for a long time. They can take control of cars already.
Okay.
I mean, your Tesla can go into, you know, it's automatic driving mode. It's also 4G connected. It's, you know, it's got apps to connect to the Tesla.
Well, the whole Tesla is one mobile app. It just has wheels.
Yeah. It's actually a stereo. You turn the volume up, and the wheels go faster.
I still remember there's an interview with Elon Musk, and he said, you know, he said in a half-joking way that there are three modes. You know, there's normal mode, that's fast, and that's insane mode, and then he said, you know, no, I wasn't kidding, you know, that really is an insane mode, where you can go from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds. In other words, your Tesla four door sedan can smoke a Porsche at a red light, any day, anytime,
all the time, with no shifting.
With no shifting, exactly, and that's why it is so fast, because a Porsche needs to shift, and that shift time is a dead time, okay? You're not accelerating when the car is shifting. Even with a dual clutch, there's still a transition time. But the Tesla has no shifting, so it just continuously accelerates. Especially with that dual motor one, you know, where the front and the back wheel, they both, you know, put traction and accelerate. And you're still getting, you know, a lot of, you know, quote unquote, miles per gallon. You know, they do a translation of electricity to, you know, gallons of gas, you know, just in terms of price, you're still saving a lot of money in that respect too. I just think of, you know, a Tesla, you know, if it ever gets into salty water, I don't know what's going to happen, but it's not going to be pretty. all those high voltage battery packs, I don't think they're waterproof. All right, kind of interesting. All right, so it is important to keep track of the values of the DAD demonstration itself. In other words, you know, the context of the app is important because the fire control app is only one aspect of the entire big project. So that is important. It's just like the Uber app itself. By itself, hey, you know, it's not going to be that important. You know, it doesn't have any purpose all by itself. It has to hook up to the Uber service. So, you know, whatever Uber is pushing, the company's vision and the company's, you know, mission statements would actually affect the design of the app. So the app itself, you know, the value of the app has to do with the overall project. Is that okay so far? Kind of? Okay. So then we talk about the actors. A UML actor, you know, for those of you who are new to the UML or the Unified Modeling Language, a UML actor is an agent that is outside of the system being specified that can interact with the system that we are trying to specify. So in this case, you know, we have a choice because are we considering the entire DAD, this entire picture, including the app itself as quote-unquote the system, or are we only looking at the app, which is the mobile device, as quote-unquote the system? Because we do have a choice. And the correct choice in this case is to only looking at the mobile device itself as the quote-unquote system, so that the interaction between the mobile device and the laptop computer through, you know, wireless connection is going to be modeled. It is not within the system. Anything that's outside of the system has to be modeled. Is that okay? Does that make sense to you?
So a laptop would be an actor in this case?
Yes. So the software running on the laptop, you know, on the laptop, you know, I just call it a coordinator. The coordinator software is considered an actor in this case because it interacts with the mobile app. And this is also why it is important to consider the mobile app itself or the mobile platform itself as a system and not include the coordinator system as a part of the system so that we can actually model the behavior or the interaction between those two. So the other actor is easy, you know, which is the end user. I would just call the end user the gunner, who is controlling the virtual firing of the drone. Are there any questions about the actors of this particular mobile app? No questions? Okay.
Is there only one gunner at a time?
For one drone, there's only one gunner at a time. However, in the actor in a use case is a classification of agents. So we only have one classification called gunner, but it does not exclude that you can have multiple instances of that actor while you're using the app. Because if you look up the UML, an actor is a classification, which is equivalent to what we call a class in Java programming. So you can have one or more instances of a gunner, you know, as applicable at any particular time. I can imagine, you know, in a certain situations, like, you know, if a drone has multiple cameras, then you can have multiple gunners, you know, one rear gunner, one side gunner, and whatnot. So, but they're all in the same classification.
Well, I mean, if it determines the gunner hit the target, they could all be gunning at separate times.
Correct.
Only one of them, I mean, you have to hit the target at the right point.
Mm-hmm, at the right.
So that way you could actually have multiple gunners while the flyer is flying. And they'll have different scores.
Yep. That's true. Then whoever's flying the drone has to coordinate with all of those gunners too. So your drone will be like spinning around as it is spinning. If there's a self-rotation while it is doing an orbit around the diesel zero. All right, so are there any questions about the actor, you know, section? No questions? Okay. So now we can move on to use cases. So a use case is basically an action of the system that can do something, but it has to support the values or purposes of the system itself. So in this case, you know, we need to enable the use of the DAD demonstration. So that would be, so whatever use cases we choose to include in the use case diagram has to connect to that. Okay. Earlier in the semester, I used the Wells Fargo Bank application as an example, where signing in is not a use case, because no one is going to install the Wells Fargo banking app just so that they can sign in. Okay. So it has to be something that is of value to at least one of the actors. So in this case, you know, firing the virtual gun is one of the use cases, because that's probably the whole point of having that app installed, is so that you can simulate, you know, the firing control of a drone in this case, and you know, attacking, you know, Diesel Zeller. Now in this particular use case, both actors, both the gunner as a user, as an actor, and also the coordinator system, which is outside of the system, would be considered actors, because it needs coordination between those two actors. So both of these actors will be connected to this particular use case, because it interacts with both users, or both actors, I should say. So in the use case diagram, how many of you know how to draw a use case diagram? I know some of you have taken CISB 362, so you should know that. If you have not taken CISB 362, it's pretty easy. A use case is basically just a bubble, and then you write down an action inside here. So it usually starts with a verb, okay, or a phrasal verb, and that would be a use case. So in this case, you know, the use case is fire virtual gun. Okay, so it's a use case, and then the actors are represented by matchstick figures. So in this case, we have two actors. One is called the gunner, which is an end user. And then the other one, which is not an actual person, but nonetheless, it is an agent that is outside of the system. And this particular app has to interact with that agent as well. And so this one is the DAD coordinator. DAD coordinator. So all you have to do is to draw a single line with no arrows to the bubble. And that makes a use case in the use case diagram, connecting the actors, whoever is involved in this case, or classification of actors, classification of agents to the particular use case that we are dealing with. Are there any questions about how to draw a use case diagram, you know, documenting a use case and the classification of agents outside of the system that can interact in this case? No questions? And the second use case may involve only the DAD coordinator to use the fire control app to update parameters in the fire control app. In other words, we might need to update the ammo count. Okay, that's one thing. If we want to make, you know, Diesel Zeller also able to retaliate, return fire, okay, then we can probably keep track of a health bar here. So that, you know, this way we can look at the health bar. So if you're flying, you know, in front of Diesel Zeller where the mouth can quote unquote breathe fire, or if you fly too close to the tail where you can whack the tail and you know, spin the tail and whack the drone, you can see the health bar going decreasing really kind of rapidly. But if you go from the blind spot, then you're safe and your health bar does not, you know, change much. So the DAD coordinator can update the display in this case, but it doesn't interact with the actual gunner in this case. So then you have a second use case, okay? Second use case is to update stats, but this time it only connects to the DAD coordinator without connecting to the gunner, because the gunner is not actively in this particular use case, but the gunner is actively using the other use case. Yep.
And the number of rounds left,
that's a very good question. You know, in fact, the very next, well, not the next one, but you know, there is somewhere in within this document, there's that question of, you know, how much intelligence do you want to put on the app and how much do you want to offload to the coordinator. So there's always that question, because if you put a lot of the logic onto the coordinator, the potential problem is you are increasing the amount of traffic. Because, you know, every single click, every single thing that you do on the app generates some kind of network message to be sent back to the coordinator program running on the PC. And anything that needs to be updated on the screen needs to originate from the PC as well. So you're talking about a round trip, that is based on network connectivity. So that might introduce some lag. But the nice thing about that part is, there's no need to update the app when you want to change the logic of things. Like, how many rounds, do we start off with? Well, that's completely controlled by the coordinator. Okay, so there's nothing you have to update on the side of the mobile app. So there's the philosophy, you can go from one extreme to the other extreme, and say, okay, how much do we want to do? How much logic do we want to contain in the app itself? Or do we want to turn the app into a dumb terminal? Right? We just report, okay, the button is held down. Send, the button down event itself to the coordinator software. So everything else is going to be done on the coordinator, including the auto reload and auto fire mechanism. So every single time, it times and say, okay, it has been 0.25 seconds and another fire is supposed to be shot. So the coordinator software will now send a message back to the app, and then the app will just kind of visually or using audio to basically let the end user know that, okay, another round has been fired. So you're pushing all the logic onto the coordinator in that case. So it's kind of hard to determine which way, especially when you have control over both components.
Yep. Is this going to be a self-contained network?
This is going to be a self-contained network.
Okay, so we're going to your own wireless.
Yep. So we're going to bring our own, Wi-Fi router, and set up our own WPA encryption. So this way, devices that are supposed to act as the fire control, mechanism, need to be joining the network first. So we will give password to those devices.
So this is a one-to-one association. So there's one coordinator for one gunner for one action.
Not necessarily.
But how did the coordinator and the gunner coordinate? I mean, are they voice?
No, it's going to be, well, the next section here. So we'll go over the requirement first, and then we'll go over communication methods, because that will answer your question.
Okay.
So the requirement is we need low latency, because you don't want to press the fire button and half a second later, a shot is fired. Because that lag, because the drone is flying and moving at the time too. So when you visually see that everything is aligned and then you click the button, but the actual action does not occur until half a second later, that can be really bad, because if the drone is flying, it can be off target already. Okay, I'm not sure how many of you watch old World War II aerial combat scenes. Okay, just imagine in those things, pilot presses the fire button, nothing happens until half a second later. There'll be a lot of cursing, I can guarantee you that. So we need low latency. We also want to make sure that there's communication integrity. We don't want anyone to be able to log into the coordinator side and just hack the result. Okay, so we want to kind of keep it, make sure that there's no hacking, no cheating in the process. We also want a reasonable range for these wireless operation, because if you have multiple teams, we don't need the multiple teams to be like really bunched up together, in the crowd. So we want to kind of give them the flexibility of, okay, you guys can be over here, the opposing team can be over there. So we want to make sure that the range of the wireless communication is enough to accommodate that. So these are reasonable requirements. They're not really a part of the value or the purpose, but nonetheless, it is important. All right, so getting back to the part where you would be interested in. There are, yeah, go ahead.
On the requirements, so the login example for the banking app,
mm-hmm.
the requirement, right?
Exactly. The login is to fulfill the requirement of authentication, mm-hmm. so that nobody can come into your account and steal all your money.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
But it's not a purpose. Okay, it is just something that is needed, but it's not a purpose of the app. The purpose of the app is convenience. All right, so getting to the ways of communication, there are three ways, main ways of communication. I didn't include near-field communication, because that won't give us the range to begin with. So if you just use the 4G or cellular networking, it's not really good because of unreliable communication speed. The unreliable communication speed has to do with several aspects. The first one is the bandwidth of 4G itself, okay, which is actually not really the biggest problem. The second part has to do with the routing through the network. Because if you just imagine, okay, you know, I have a cell phone right here. So if you just kind of imagine that I'm using my 4G signal on the cell phone to communicate with that computer over there, it's going on a big round trip because it has to go to a cell tower. The cell tower has to go back to the main, you know, one of the main nodes of T-Mobile. T-Mobile has to get onto the main trunk of the internet, and then that has to route it back to the main trunk connected to Los Rios District, and that has to route back to the campus and then back to this computer. Okay, that's, we're going through a lot of hops, a lot of routers in that process. And if there's any congestion on any one of those routers, the lag time is gonna increase. Does that make any sense? On the other hand, if you choose anything that is not going outside, including Bluetooth, then you don't have to go through all those hops. But Bluetooth has one particular problem. It has a shorter range compared to Wi-Fi signals. What is the typical range of a class one Bluetooth device? Does anyone know?
33 feet.
Yep, 33 feet because it's 10 meters. The Europeans, you know, they use 10 meters and that's about 11 yards by our standard. Okay, so that's about 33 feet. How long is 33 feet? It's a little bit more than that, you know, but not much. Okay, so it's a limited range, and a lot of times, you know, when they classify a device as a class one, you know, a lot of times the actual range is shorter than 33 feet, because the 33 feet is based on ideal, you know, situations, and you have line of sight, you have no interference, and no noises around the whole thing. And guess what's going to happen in State Fair? None of those things, right? You have a lot of people. You have a lot of cell phone devices, a lot of Bluetooth devices, and somebody's gonna, you know, use a microwave oven to cook something, and guess what that's gonna do?
It's only to the 10-yard line, right?
Hmm?
It's only to the 10-yard line.
Sorry?
10-yard line.
10-yard line.
Yeah, 33.
33, yeah.
It's not far.
It's not very far, but if anyone turns on a microwave oven, you know, your effective range is probably shrunk to a quarter of what it's supposed to. I know that because every time I use the microwave oven, my son, who has his laptop computer kind of like about 10 feet away from the microwave oven, would complain because he would not be able to play his game anymore.
Really?
Oh yeah. Because all of those things operate at about 2.4 gigahertz. Okay. So you can look this up. It's really kind of interesting. Wi-Fi frequency microwave. There we go. Okay. So Wi-Fi, not counting the 5 gigahertz range, is about from 2.4 to 2.0. You know, it's within the 2.4 gigahertz range with a bandwidth of 20 megahertz and a 2 megahertz band gap. Okay. And the frequency of your microwave is really close to that. Okay, so look at this one here. The answer, okay, we have to find the frequency used by microwave, you know, oven. Okay, maybe we just look at that. Microwave frequency, there we go. So microwave is a wide range, so we have to use microwave oven. So that will limit our range. Okay, there we go. Considering the frequency of 2.45 gigahertz, the frequency of microwave radiation is basically dead in the center of the Wi-Fi frequency. So there you go. If you want to interfere with somebody else's, you know, the Wi-Fi connection, you know, just rip the door out of a microwave oven. Use a remote mechanism to turn it on, because I wouldn't be standing next to that thing when it turns on.
So then you have a broadcast, you know, what we call a jammer. Okay, so you can jam, you know, all frequency, all communication within that range.
You can probably just gut it. Yeah.
Just get the magnetron out of it, right? Yeah, we all. Yeah, go ahead.
So that's leakage that's causing the interference.
Yeah, it's just the leakage that's causing you know the communication loss in this case.
The mesh in front of that door is supposed to be catching the.
Yeah, it's supposed to have the effect of a Faraday cage,
that's right.
So it doesn't let a certain frequency range getting out of it. You can actually Radio Shack used to sell these meters. You know, they can kind of inspect your microwave oven and see how much is leaking out of it. Now, microwave, even though we think of microwave as being really harmful and stuff like that, it does take time for microwave oven to do its damage. Because the damaging effect of microwave oven is it heats up stuff. It heats up water. So if you put a cup of water in a microwave oven and you turn it to the maximum, how long would it take to boil the water? Two minutes or so? Well, let's say 8 ounces. So it takes some time to boil, right? And guess how much water you have in your body? Is it 8 ounces? With 70% of water, so with
it's
a 100-pound person, 75 pounds of water.
That's good salt.
Well, radiation, the water just isn't absorbing all that. I mean, if you put a piece of meat in the microwave 20 seconds, that's more. You put potatoes in there for 20 seconds, they're cold.
Because a potato has more thermal mass, so it takes a little bit longer to heat it up. You know, so if you look at the volume of 8 ounces of meat versus 8 ounces of potato, the 8 ounces of potato doesn't take up as much space. It's a little denser. So that means if you open up the microwave oven and it's actually leaking microwave, you would feel a warming effect before you die, long before you die. Of being cooked.
Which is what radiation is anyway, right?
Hmm?
Which is what radiation is anyway.
Well, it's one form of radiation, but it's not the kind of radiation like gamma ray or X-ray where it can do cellular level damage. This one is just warming, and people, if anyone's going to die from microwave exposure, it's dying from being cooked slowly, very slowly. It's kind of like dying from toxic gas exposure, except the gas in this case is H2S, which is really stinky. You're gonna move away. You will say, okay, I'm getting unusually warm. I'm gonna figure out why that is the case long before you get cooked. But it is good to still have a shield. But it's kind of interesting that you can use something like this to disturb or disrupt communication, with Wi-Fi. And guess what else? Bluetooth. Bluetooth actually uses the same frequency range. If you look up Bluetooth frequency, it is about the same range. Bluetooth. There you go. See, Bluetooth is just a little bit higher, but it is right within that range. And microwaves, in the previous slide, this is the center of the wave, but it is not a notch. In other words, a microwave oven emits frequencies that are surrounding this center, and it's broad spectrum. So that means it probably goes all the way down to 2.4 gigahertz and probably all the way up to 2.6 gigahertz. So anything within that range is going to be disrupted.
And that's because of the power level, right?
Hmm?
That's because of the power level, you're putting out a lot more power.
You're putting into a lot of power into the microwave, but with the door closed, that should block out most of the radiation. I mean, nothing outside is going to get heated up, for instance. It's just insignificant for heating purposes, but it will still disrupt Wi-Fi and Bluetooth communication.
So you can put my hand on the door and see if it heats up, and then that will help.
It probably won't heat up the hand at all. It's the same myth, that people say that your Bluetooth, your cell phone, can cook your brain. I mean, it just doesn't happen because your brain has so much water content compared to the power level of your cell phone. It has a negligible, effect on your brain. So there you go, fun stuff. And we want to go back to the notes. Where is it? There we go. Okay.
So Bluetooth is not going to be usable in this case because of the shorter range. And also Bluetooth is an end-to-end communication. It's not a client-server type of communication. So Wi-Fi is the best choice because in this case, depending on which Wi-Fi standard, if you use Wi-Fi N, it has a pretty good bandwidth already. And the new AC standard is even better. So you know we are talking about almost wired communication speed these days when we are dealing with wireless. Now, of course, wired these days can do gigabits per second as opposed to hundreds of megabits per second, but it's still much better than even the older technology of wired communication. There was a time when wired communication can only go up to 10 megabits per second, and Wi-Fi has long exceeded that range of communication speed. All right. So after you get things done, this is not in a particular sequence. Wait, did I address the question about the communication?
I was just wondering how the gunner and the coordinator.
Okay.
The person flying or the drone pilot and the gunner, are they talking to each other? Fly left, fly right.
The gunner and the pilot, they will communicate in real life because they're just two people, right, in the team.
So voice and visual cues and whatever else they want to use.
Yeah, you can even have the same person, doing the flying and also the shooting at the same time, although that's going to be hard because to fly a drone needs both hands already. So you need a foot control for fire control in that case. Stomp on something.
Use case, yeah.
Yep.
What about a trigger on their hand somehow, on the controller or
then you need a separate device to do that control. Yep.
It wouldn't be a mobile app anymore, I guess, or it would be a device connected to an app.
You can hook up that device to an app, like using maybe a headphone connection, because they use the headphone connection for those selfie sticks, right?
Oh yeah.
So I can kind of imagine that you can use the same kind of mechanism and use a selfie stick trigger or selfie stick toggle to do the fire control, so this way you can integrate the whole thing into the remote control. But then you also have to keep an eye on the ammo count. Yep.
This is all within one room?
This is all within, I don't think it's going to be in, I don't know whether it's going to be a indoor or an outdoor event, which is one of the concerns, because if it's an outdoor event, then the lighting from outside is a lot more unpredictable compared to indoor lighting. So whether the LEDs are bright enough for the video analyzer to kind of tell that, okay, we can see something turn on and something turn off, that becomes a potential issue. Because when you're outside, the ambient lighting can be so bright that the LED lighting, turning on and turning off does not give you enough signal to be recognized. So that's a valid concern. But these LEDs are pretty bright. I mean, these are the ones, if you click on the hyperlink, so let me go back to here. So these are truck markers. And they're pretty bright. I mean, if you look at trucks, 18-wheelers, sometimes some of those would turn on the markers even during the day. And even during the day, they're slightly visible. So I think between the on and the off state, you can still tell the difference. I thought about putting some of these on my Miata too, but then my mechanic said, no, it's not going to look very good on your car. Yeah, that was a point when I was very concerned because people cannot see me. Because I had a black Miata that had a lower suspension, and there were a few near misses where people just did not see me. They just big trucks. They look at the rear mirror. I'm so low that they could not actually see me down there. So they just make a lane change without seeing me at all.
It's like a Christmas vacation where the car goes underneath the big logging truck. Seen that movie?
Yeah.
Fast and Furious.
Fast and Furious did it a few times.
Are they going to
I actually parked my car next to an 18-wheeler. It's just because of the roll bar, it's just a little bit too tall to slide under a truck. Yep.
I drive looking through the window of the car in front of me. when I get too low, I do not like this anymore.
Well, if I'm following a truck with my old Miata, I look under the truck to see what is in front of me. I'm not kidding you. I kid you not, sir. I can look under the truck to see what is ahead of me. Which is kind of cool. All right. So we are now talking about the mock sequences. Okay, so once you have, you know, the use cases, it doesn't hurt to go through, you know, a few, you know, simulated cases. So you can basically think about, you know, how the different actors can interact. So a particular type of diagram in the UML is called a sequence diagram. Okay, that's exactly the name of that type of diagram. In a sequence diagram, they have lanes. Okay, I've got to erase this. So basically, you have lanes of that are representing users. So you have, you know, agent one, and then you have agent two, and then you have the system itself. And then all of these are represented by lanes. A lane is basically a vertical line that goes from top to bottom. It is representing time, okay? So the progress of time is going in this direction, and the interactions are represented by horizontal lines like this, okay? So you can now, you know, basically document. I know this pen is not working, so let me just put it aside. But basically, you can use a sequence diagram to look at a simulated, you know, sequence of using a particular use case. So hopefully that will basically have you to think about, oh, what if we lose communication? What if, you know, something bad happens? How do we want the system to handle that? So you're basically running through the system with all the exception or error scenario so that you can kind of figure out, okay, we need to handle this case, we need to handle this case, and so on. Is that okay? Okay. So we can look at what is a sequence diagram. Sequence diagram in the UML. And that's exactly what it looks like. It's literally just, you know, displaying, you know, how things interact between the computer and the server. You send unsent email and send a new email, response, download email. It's just, you know, one particular sequence of how a particular use case may happen. The UML is definitely, I would say the UML does not, is not used a lot in Agile. Okay, would you agree that in Agile development, people do not use the UML a whole lot?
It's not used all that much. I mean, it's still a way to represent. It's like a schematic.
Right. Right, but they're not really set on, you know, I'm not going to start working until I have the activity diagram, you know, all done. Because that would kind of go against the Agile philosophy.
I mean, it doesn't eliminate design and analysis,
right,
and integration and testing. It just says we're not going to plan the project out at the end of next year. What we're
right.
going to do is we're going to plan out the next 3 weeks, and we're going to hit that goal.
Right.
We're going to measure how well we do each 3 week sprint.
Right.
So we can learn what works, what doesn't work. We take it on too much. You took on three tasks, you take on two.
Yeah.
So we get better, and then at the end of the year, we think we're going to be farther
mm-hmm.
by always keeping a working product.
Right.
And we would be by designing it out for a year, starting in 6 months, you know, throwing away all the documentation. It was all wrong. It didn't think about this. It didn't consider that.
But when you do the UML and you do the full, you know, blown, you know, UML documentation, that's going to take a long time.
Yeah, that's the everything stuff is.
Yep.
Is the part
you would use it, you know, to represent, you know, or to diagram certain things, you know, when the visual diagram is a lot easier to understand than just code.
Absolutely.
Right, but not for the sake of, you know, we just need to hit every single UML diagram there is.
Yeah, not to pre-plan the design. Of
yep.
It's
yep.
documented.
That's what I meant. All right. So are there any questions about this part? A sequence diagram and the value of a sequence diagram. It kind of let you kind of think out, you know, all the possible, you know, interaction between the actors and the system. Yep.
And you have multiple sequence diagrams for the
yes.
sequence.
Yeah, each sequence diagram is kind of like a mocked up, you know, scenario of how something may happen when somebody is using the app. It doesn't actually contain the logic to handle that case. It just displays, it just documents how you think the system should interact in that case. Like, you know, if the communication is to break, okay, what is the system going to do? What is this app going to do when, for whatever reason, you lost communication with the coordinator? Okay, you know, do you want it to just hang and, you know, or do you want to time out, report to the user, or back off the screen, back to the main screen, or give the user a choice? Do you want to retry the connection? So the sequence diagram is just for you to document the desirable behavior of the application in these different types of scenarios. It doesn't specify the logic, it doesn't do anything, but it does give you, a repertoire of, let's make sure that whatever logic we specify in the software will handle all of these cases like that. Okay, so this part is the most interesting part is how do we do the remote communication? In other words, because the app has to communicate with the coordinator software that's running on a laptop computer. So that coordination, is what interests me the most, because I'm, for the most part, a back-end type of programmer, not a user interface front-end, type of programmer. Okay, so to talk about this part, there are several things that we have to consider. But I'm going to skip this part just for the time being, because I want to skip all the way to objects, okay? Because we are kind of running out of time, but I think this part is actually the most important part. One of the most important part of developing software using OOP, or object-oriented programming paradigm, is to identify the objects. Well, that part kind of goes without saying, because we don't say something is object-oriented unless there are objects. So the question now is, what are objects, and how do we identify these objects? Some objects are visible, and they are really easy to kind of see, because these are the things representing visual elements that the user can interact with. A button is an object, okay? Your whole screen, which is called an activity, is an object. Your label, which is a text view, is an object. Okay, so all of those things are objects. But those are the visible objects, and we don't miss those things because they're visible. Okay? And the Android programming interface will even pre-program some of those things for you. Like the activity is a class, okay, and the system generates code for you. So you don't have to worry about those things. And for the most part also, these objects are also supplied, or these classes are supplied by the Android hierarchy, so you don't have to think about that either. So some objects are invisible, like in the fire control app, the firing mechanism itself is going to be an object because it has multiple states. So anytime you're dealing with something that has multiple states that can respond to events and can do things on its own, those basically are indicators that you have an object. So the firing mechanism is an object. It has several states. So this is basically just outlining the states and how you can transition from one state to another state. The initial state is pretty easy. The firing mechanism is created when the activity starts and automatically transitions to the default state, which is the trigger released state. In the trigger release state, it is representing the physical property of a trigger not being pulled. Okay, it is released. So it's not being triggered. If the safety released condition is met, okay, so this is what we call a guard condition, then a pull event transitions to a trigger pulled state. In other words, you can draw a picture about this. You can draw a picture where the states are represented by bubbles, and then the transitions are represented by arrows. When you're in the trigger pulled state, the trigger is pulled, it's representing a trigger in the state of being pulled. So in that case, if the ammo available guard condition is met, then you can transition directly to the shot fired state automatically. And this transition needs to notify the DAD coordinator, because the DAD coordinator needs the timing to know that, a virtual round is fired. And it needs that timing
to coordinate with the visual analyzing software to see if an LED is right at the center of the crosshair. Is that making any sense?
So then you transition into a shot fired state, which is representing a shot has just been fired. Now, in this particular state, if the guard conditions, there are two guard conditions in this case. The first guard condition is auto mode is enabled, and then the second one is ammo is available. If both of these conditions are met, then you basically transition into auto delay state automatically, which is simulating, you know, the mechanical aspect of a auto reload mechanism. So it takes time to, you know, put another round into the chamber and stuff like that. So it's basically simulating the delay of that. It can also transition directly back to the trigger released state to correspond to respond to a trigger release event. So if someone is to release the button,
then you would basically go back to the trigger release state and nothing is going to happen after that point. So we are talking about transitions from one state to another state. When you get to the auto delay state, then there's a mechanism. It is representing the waiting of a automatic mechanism, you know, which is a mechanical mechanism to reload and get ready for the next shot. And in this case, the next, when the timer event, when the timer expires, then you will transition back into the trigger pull state, which is down here. So once again, when you transition back to this state, if there's ammo available, then you will transition to a shot fired state again to represent another fire, another round has been fired. Is that okay?
What happens if the trigger has been released?
The trigger release is only handled, it's only handled in this case. And also, there's one more.
You gotta go to shot fired in the auto.
Yes. Because, you know, but
so
I think.
After you release the trigger, you get one more shot.
Yes, if it is already in that action, already in the motion of reloading and firing the next shot. And I think that is the case with a with an actual weapon too, is, you know, if you press the, if you're dealing with a, I don't have any experience, but some of you may, but most of Californians do not have experience with a fully automatic weapon.
I'll bring my AK in tomorrow.
But you don't have a fully automatic AK. It's illegal in the state of California. We have to have a little field trip to Nevada to do all that. But you can probably look up online and find out, you know, the actual mechanism. But I think, you know, when you have already started the mechanism to reload and fire the next shot and you release the trigger, it will still fire that shot before it, you know, stops. Because otherwise, you know, the round's gonna get chambered, right?
That's what happened.
No,
you have like a
always
clock.
End up with a round chamber.
It would just end up with a round chambered, but it won't fire the round.
And even in single shot or three round burst, you still end up with a round chambered.
Okay, so if so, as soon as you release the trigger, the firing mechanism will not work anymore.
Yeah, it should load the chamber.
Okay, so I need additional states in this case. So it needs an additional state, you know, basically, you know, to separate, you know, chambering and firing, to separate those into two different events. Or two different states.
Just to make things complicated.
Yeah, but the nice thing about, you know, modeling to resemble actual, you know, the physical, you know, characteristics is you can actually have sound effects to go with it. You can even hear the pin going, you know, when you listen very carefully. Okay, but in this case, you know, it is going to, you know, fire that, you know, last round, you know, even after you release the trigger. But in order to do it the right way, you know, we need an additional state, you know, separating the chambering and the actual firing. Because otherwise, you know, there's no way to interpret, no place to interpret trigger release to stop the firing. Okay. And you know, but the whole point is, you know, this is a, you can use a state diagram to represent all of this stuff here. It is a lot more difficult to read this than to read a state diagram with the bubbles and the arrows and stuff like that. But the key here is, in addition to states, you know, we have transitions. So each transition has all of these properties. Each transition has an optional guard condition, which can be a conjunction of a whole bunch of other, you know, smaller guard conditions. A guard condition can be specified. If it is not met, then the transition cannot happen. So a guard condition is just a conditional statement to basically say, if these conditions are not met, nothing is going to happen. A transition can specify an event. An event is basically something happening, and typically it is something happening that is asynchronous to the execution of this program, something that you cannot time, something you cannot predict. In the absence of an event, the transition would occur automatically after the guard condition is met. The tricky part is, what if an event is not specified, but a guard condition is? So in that case, how do we handle it? Because, you know, now you're basically waiting for the guard condition to become true. But how frequently do we check whether the guard condition is true or not? That becomes a problem, because the state diagram doesn't say anything about, oh, try again in 5 milliseconds. It just says, okay, you know, there's no event associated with this transition. As soon as the guard condition becomes true, go forward. So the biggest problem is, you know, are we busy waiting, are we polling, or are we going to specify a timeout and say, okay, we'll come back and check in 5 milliseconds? How much time do we want to allow before we check again? So that question is not answered in this particular case. A transition can contain an action. This action is performed by the object itself, which is usually represented by a method of the class that is being used to describe the object. Is that okay? So that's why, you know, when you analyze, when you look at objects and you draw a state diagram related to an object, it will become kind of clear what kind of methods you have to deal with, and also what kind of events your object has to listen to. Because those events are the ones that are causing the transitions to happen. Is that okay? All right. And the change of the state or the maintenance of the state is usually pretty easy, because you just need to maintain, you know, a particular member, usually an integer, to basically track which state are we in at this point, at any point of time. Are there any questions about, you know, a state diagram and what it, the importance of a state diagram in object-oriented programming? Can anyone see how this relates to the MVA discussion, the model view adapter discussion? Sort of? Because the model is basically a state machine. And it responds to events by doing things. Okay. All right. So we have, you know, the last section here talks about, you know, network communication and state transitions. Now this one is kind of, you know, interesting, because with buttons clicking and, you know, timer expiring and stuff like that, those events are automatically generated by the Android operating system. I'm just, you know, resizing the window to the point where we can see it on the, see the whole thing in the, on the projector. Okay, there we go. Okay. So with certain events, it's easy because the operating system is taking care of those events for you. When you click on something on the screen, you know, an event is triggered. So all you have to do is to make sure that you listen to that event and respond to it. So that's not too difficult. Network communication doesn't have anything like that. There are three main classes to deal with network communication. And then I can show you which three we are talking about. So the first one is a Android socket class. And this is kind of way beyond the scope of this class, you know, but for those of you who are interested in communication or having your app to actually open up sockets to talk to a remote server, this may be something that you want to look into. A socket is basically representing a channel of communication in a client-server type of setting. So when you're dealing with a socket, when you look at all the methods of a socket, these are the constructors, but these are the public methods. You can have bind, basically you're binding a socket to a certain address. You can close a socket. You can make a connection. You know, this is a client making a connection to a server. You can get a channel. You can get INET address, input stream, blah, blah, blah. The actual communication is done by sending, send urgent data, send 1 byte of urgent data on the socket. And let's see, we can read back something too. Okay, the reading back has to do with the channel, so you have to go back to socket channel. Oh, get input stream, you can return an input stream, and then once you have an input stream, you can start to read from the stream itself. You can also go to a socket channel to do further communication. So a socket channel is for stream-oriented connecting sockets, which applies to TCP connections.
Because a TCP connection is giving you a stream-like communication, you can basically transmit bytes, and the bytes are guaranteed to receive in the correct order on the other side. That's the one of the nice thing about TCP. But it doesn't have any events. When you look at these classes, all the classes related to sockets do not have events. There's no on listen to, there's no on reception of bytes or on transmission of bytes or anything like that. When you are about to receive something and you're reading and there's nothing to read, it simply blocks. Okay, so let me see if I can find it here. Okay, right here. So the read operation is a blocking call. Now, you can either make it a blocking call, you can make it not a blocking call, where it will just return the number of bytes available at a time, and then it stops. So now we have a problem, because when this particular program, when the app is waiting for the coordinator software to send back something, to update the display, to change the state, there's no actual event associated with it. From the perspective of Android events, there are no events corresponding to having a connection initiated by the laptop computer back to the mobile device. So how do we handle that?
Polling.
You can do a polling, but you can also do two threads. Okay? So you can open a thread if you're opening a connection channel between the app and the coordinator. You can have one thread just to monitor that particular channel or that particular stream. When there is an incoming packet or incoming message and say, oh, go ahead and update your display, your ammo count is now down to blah, 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 okay? So upon reception of that message, the thread that is doing the network communication can then trigger the execution. It can then inquire who is listening to me, and then it will notify whoever is listening to the network communication object and say that, okay, here, your this is your new ammo count, do something about it. This is getting back to the MVA approach, except in this case you don't really have a V, you don't have a view, you basically have two M's that are basically communicating with each other. The adapter is still sitting in between and say, oh, okay, this guy is, I'm, so the, okay, let me see if I can draw that picture. So in this case, you have a model and another model. There are two objects. One is communicated. This is a communication object, and this is the fire control. So there are two objects, one representing how you communicate with the coordinator component on the laptop computer. The other one is corresponding to the internal logic of fire control. You have an adapter in between. So it's MAM approach or MMA approach. Whenever the communication object says, oh, we just received something from the coordinator, we need to update the ammo count, or we need to update the health count, we need to update the time remaining count on the screen, this object, which is an adapter, is listening to this model object here. So when the model object says, okay, we just received something, you know, whoever is listening to me, now you need to do something. So at that time, you know, this will initiate an action because the adapter is a listener. The adapter being an adapter would say, I don't know what to do with it, but I'm connected to something else that might. So the adapter will then call a method in the fire control object and say, hey, you know, the communication object just said something, you might want to know about it and do something about it. Is that okay? So that's why, you know, so this is what we can do to get around the problem of not actually having events from the perspective of the Android operating system. We basically register, you know, the adapter as a listener of the communication object, and then the communication object has its own thread of listening, waiting for a message. When a message is received, then the communication object in the communication thread is going to make a call to whoever is listening to it, and then the adapter will in return make a call to the fire control mechanism. Not sure how much of this is getting across, but but it does involve multiple threads. You cannot use a single thread anymore, because if you use a single thread, we have a big problem. When you use a single thread, when it is calling the read method, or when it's calling the connect method, these are what we call blocking methods. A blocking method means, you know, you can call it, but if nobody wants to make a connection with you and you're waiting for a connection, guess what? You're gonna wait until somebody is going to make a connection to you. If you're doing that in your UI or user interface / main thread, then your main thread is also blocked, which basically means, you know, the end user can click on anything on the screen and nothing is gonna happen. Because it is completely blocked, it cannot go back and grab the next message to process. So that's why you need a separate, you know, thread in this case, just to handle the communication. Yep.
So would that thread that's handling the communication be doing polling on its own?
Nope, it's not polling. It's being blocked, basically. So when you look at a socket, there's a call, you know, called connect. Connect this socket to a server and specify timeout value, which basically means it is going to block until if you specify a timeout, then the timeout will happen and then it will come back and say, we could not get a connection within that amount of time.
So how does that solve the problem of not having an event when something changes on the DAD?
Because the rest of the system is running on a different thread. So when you're waiting for connection, it doesn't impact the rest of the system.
But the thread that's doing the communication is able to see that something has happened and
yes.
Relay that back.
Yes.
But it doesn't have to keep communicating constantly.
Right,
with
because the objects are not affiliated with a particular thread. An object is nothing more than an encapsulation of a bunch of data and a bunch of methods that is sitting in memory. Okay, so your communication thread can utilize the object as much as your UI thread can utilize the same object. So Java provides, you know, internal mechanisms where your two threads cannot access the same object at exactly the same time. So it locks out one thread when the other thread is still using an object. So that for that you have to be careful, because, you know, if the communication thread is blocking when you're making a connect call, that object is no longer accessible from the main thread. So the interlocking mechanism will prevent that from happening.
When you say blocking, what do you mean by blocking?
Blocking means it's just waiting. You know, that particular thread is put on quote-unquote suspension, or, you know, is sleeping until, you know, there's actually a connection coming in.
But it could possibly still be blocking or using an object while it's doing that? No?
Yes, because if the connect call is within a method of that object, it would then be blocking that object. So that object cannot be accessed from another thread.
Okay.
But that's why the timeout is important, because you don't want it to block indefinitely. Is that okay? Because there are two concepts that are kind of confusing. One is what is an object as opposed to what is a thread. Do you guys remember that picture? I drew that picture a little while ago to describe what is a process, what is a thread, and what objects are. So a process is actually, you know, drawing a boundary of your application and say only things within this process can see the memory space within here. Another process has no way of, you know, getting into this memory space and mess things up. That's that's why we need a concept of a process. Within a process, you can have objects, right? So the objects are memory things that exist within the memory space of a process. What a thread is a point of execution. So the point of execution can execute, and then it can access a particular object, use a particular method of an object, and then it's done with it, access another one, like that. And then you can have a parallel thread, you know, parallel to this one, that is using the other object. And it can even use other objects like this. They cannot be in the same object at the same time. That's the only, you know, lockout mechanism. It's called a mutual exclusion, or otherwise known as mutex, N-U-T-E-X. So the mutex mechanism is built into Java, so that, you know, when you use a particular object from one thread, the object is blocked from other threads. Other threads have to wait for one thread to get out of the object before other threads can get in. Is that making any sense? Because the problem of having two threads accessing the same object at exactly the same time is when they interleave, one object can make some changes to some of the members of one object, and then the other thread can come in interleaving, and not knowing that some of those properties have changed, and continue its own execution point. So now when you have the two threads interleaving within the methods of one particular object, then you can have unexpected results. And that's why, you know, we need to have mutual exclusion when you're talking about objects from multiple threads. Yep.
You said that's built into Java.
I think that is the case. Java code has, you know, is thread aware, which means, you know, when you get into objects from multiple threads, it knows, you know, that it is being accessed from which thread. So you can look it up and look for Java object thread save. Okay, so thread safe means a method or class instance, an object basically, can be used by multiple threads at the same time without problems occurring. So it will automatically lock out certain things. So now thread A and thread B both would like to execute add one, but thread A starts first and read the value. For some reason, the thread schedule decides to halt or pause, suspend, you know, thread A and defer execution to thread B. So the interleaving is going to be problematic. But because the method is not implemented in a thread safe way, the value is going to messed up. So you can mark a method as synchronized. Okay, so by default it is not thread safe. You have to mark it as synchronized. So that basically indicates to the Java virtual machine to make sure that there's a lockout mechanism. So without synchronized, it is not automatically a thread safe. So I stand corrected.
That's talking about methods there.
Right.
So.
But everything is a method.
Could be an object. Right.
Yeah. Because any code in Java is a method. Unlike in C and C++, where you can have standalone subroutines,
oh, right.
Java does not have standalone subroutines. Oh. So every time you execute any code, it has to be inside a method. But if you do not mark the method as synchronized, then there's no locking out mechanism to lock out other threads. But when you mark a method as synchronized, then it becomes, you know, thread safe. All right. Any questions? So I think this is all that we have time for today. I want you guys to start to think about your projects, but we will definitely go into communication, definitely get into HTTP type of communication, which is a whole lot easier. It's similar to using sockets because it is an instance of using sockets, but you know, they make it a little bit easier too. So a lot of the status of an HTTP connection can be reported as a part of the method of that particular class. So that makes it easier. It also provides ways for you to integrate parameters into HTTP request. So HTTP is one of the things that is pretty easy to do inside Java, in Android. So if you look up HTTP, we'll do this next week. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys a sample program where it can make a connection to a server, get the result, and then it'll continue execution. So HTTP communication in Android. I looked this up already. So look to connecting to the network, URL connection. It just makes things really easy to deal with. It's actually not a part of Android. It's a part of Java. And it gives you a pretty easy interface to make connections. So here's the code. You have to create a URL object, use the URL object to open a connection. And when this returns, then it is the connection is opened. Then you can go ahead and use a stream to get the reply from that HTTP request. And read stream is just reading in the stream opened in this case because it's using the in object. If the connection fails, then you have to disconnect or just stop the connection itself. Yep.
Does finally handle any exceptions during the try block?
I do not know. Yeah, because I don't usually program in Java. So I think the try, because try usually associates with
try catch.
Yeah. So finally probably is.
It's executed in both cases, exception or otherwise.
Yeah. Exception or not, it jumps to, it's a catch all. Okay. Okay. So regardless of whether you get into an exception or not, or going through the try block, at the end of the try block, it will get to the finally block. Gotcha. So this will guarantee to disconnect the.
Is this easy to build an HTTP server?
No, this is an HTTP client. If you want to build an HTTP server, I know what class you need to look into too. Yep, server sockets. So you need to look into server sockets, and then you have to maintain socket connections.
Aren't you going to use HTTP to come across to the DAD controller?
It doesn't have to be HTTP.
So you're going to use raw sockets.
I haven't really thought about. Okay. The problem with HTTP or any connection based communication is there's a lot of overhead involved whenever you make a connection. And HTTP is notorious for doing that sort of thing because if you use HTTP, each connection is actually fairly short lived, right? You make a HTTP request, it comes back with a reply, and that connection is done. And the next time when you open another connection, it has to go through the same negotiation process and a lot of overhead in order to make another connection. And that's why a lot of gaming protocols do not use TCP, because TCP relies on needs a lot of overhead. But the good thing about TCP is it guarantees the ordering of the bytes and guarantee of delivery. But instead of doing that, since we are maintaining our own state machines, right, we can detect problems by timing out and stuff like that. It is actually more efficient to use UDP instead, to use datagram. Because datagrams have very low overhead when it comes to the network stack because it doesn't guarantee anything. Okay, there's no guarantee of delivery. If you send two datagrams, you send datagram A first, and then you send datagram B, there's no guarantee that A is going to be arriving before B. But because of the lack of all of that ordering, guarantee of delivery, and stuff like that, it's fast. It has a very low latency. But the downside is, you know, all the handshaking, all the error checking and stuff like that, now you have to handle it because the connection itself does not guarantee it anymore. So I'm kind of tempted in this particular scenario to use a UDP or datagram, you know, based communication instead of TCP communication, which is connection based. So I haven't decided yet, you know, just, you know, kind of,
you can craft out that using a little Node.js server and just use post commands coming out of there.
You could do that, yep. You make a tiny little server, you know, out of the app, responding to HTTP requests from the PC itself.
The other way around.
You want it the other way around?
Yeah, you just post the fire, right?
The fire, yes. But the other side has to tell you how much time is remaining. Now, you have two ways to keep track of time, because you know, each run, you know, let's say each run is only 10 minutes, right? So somebody has to keep track of time, and it would be nice for the app itself to display, you know, how much time is remaining. So how do you keep track of time? You can do it in one of two ways. You can, at the very beginning of the entire session, they can synchronize the time. So the start is, you know, started from here, and it tells the app and say, okay, start now. Okay, and then the two devices, the laptop and the mobile device, will now track time in parallel. But if you have any type of drift, then you can have a problem at the end of the event. Because the PC can register, okay, this is the end of the match, before the app says, okay, this is the end of the match. So that very last thing that you fire, is it gonna count or not? Because to the gunner, the app is still active, thinking, okay, we have one more shot to do. But that shot, when it gets to the notebook says, nope, we ran out of time already. So I would personally just use one single thing for timing, which is the PC. So the PC would basically every second update the time remaining display on the mobile side and just say, okay, this is how much time you have left.
Seems safer.
Well, it's more consistent, because this way there's no way that the time can drift enough where one side thinks there's enough time, more time, and then the other side thinks, you know, we are out of time. But that's just, you know, how I, you know, think of it. Because anytime you have two parallel timing mechanisms, you always have to deal with, you know, what if there's a drift.
So I say a man with one watch knows what time it is. A man with two watches is never sure.
Well, it depends on whether it's a sunny day or not during the day, because you can then look at the shadow.
You're just never sure what watch it is. That's what you're saying.
Yep.
Two watches, 2 clocks, you wouldn't be sure.
That's a good saying. Very wise. All right, so I'll leave it up to you guys to think about what you want to do for your app. But this is actually increasingly the case for apps. It is not something that's standalone anymore. The value of the app is it is enabling something else to happen. You're not installing the app just because the app itself has a value. It's not like a game, you know, on a mobile device. It's not like a dictionary on a mobile device. You know, this is enabling something else to happen. All right. So now that you know about this project, if you want to kind of participate in this, you know, just let me know, because you know I'm pretty sure we can use more people to kind of get this done.
When is it happening?
We want to be able to get this done by the state fair, which is in mid-July. And of course, our classes end in mid-May. So there's no guarantee that anyone is going to be around after mid-May to continue to work on this. Do you know how Randy wants to do this?
No, but I'm really interested in that. I'm surprised he didn't say that there was an app going on with this.
Well, because I haven't told him yet.
Oh. <That's hard. laughs>
Because he just said, you know, he needs some software people to do
the
video processing. But if you're just doing the video processing without the mobile app, then it's just a matter of flying the drone, you know, make sure it points to one of the LEDs. That's it, right? You know, there's not much fun involved in that. Yep.
So in your DAD coordinators, is that handling the other team?
You can have.
Or is it just handling your app?
I would use only one DAD process for each team.
So now you have the time problem all over again.
You got to coordinate time. I mean, I'm still shooting and you're done.
But they can both be reporting to the same, you know, centralized mechanism.
Oh, so now you have another.
Oh, okay. I see what you mean. They can be done with only one single, you know, coordinator because the two teams are identified by different IP addresses. Because
but
the mobile apps.
Now the coordinator has multiple flyers.
It has multiple threads.
Multiple flyers, multiple drones.
Yeah. Which is not a big deal. I mean, that's easy to deal with. It just has multiple threads, you know, one thread to. It will end up with multiple threads anyway.
Oh yeah, multiple threads are your friend. Threads are your friend. It's kind of like recursion. You know, once you figure it out, life's easier.
But that requires an operating system that supports threading. Have you ever read the source code of Squid?
Well, we did threading. We did threading back when we didn't have an operating system that supported it. And kind of a pseudo.
Okay, so I would recommend that you read the source code of this thing. It's Squid, which is a proxy server. Okay, there we go. Okay, so Squid is really interesting. It's a caching and forwarding HTTP web server. And the nice thing about Squid is you put a Squid installation onto a gateway of your network router, and it can basically, you know, so let's say 100 people in the internal network, they all try to access the same HTML document or the same GIF. The caching mechanism basically will only go outside once, and then understanding that it's the same file that 100 computers inside the network are trying to access, it will just feed it internally to those 100 computers. So you can basically, assuming nothing is going through HTTPS, because it cannot deal with HTTPS, assuming all of those are HTTP connections, you can save a lot of bandwidth, outside bandwidth. Okay? But the funny part about the Squid is it is a single thread program. It can handle hundreds, even thousands of simultaneous connections, but it's only using one single thread. So when you read the source code, it's a jigsaw puzzle. Because the way they do it is to use the select call in low-level operating system, you know, concepts. There's a select call where you can basically say, you can tell the operating system and say that, okay, look at these 3,000 sockets, okay? If any one of these 3,000 sockets has any activity, like more bytes to read or has room to write more bytes, unblock this process, unblock this thread. And that's how it can maintain multiple thousands of connections using only one thread. It's based on that one single operating system call that can unblock when any one of the 3,000, you know, connections that you're monitoring has something to do, something further to do. So, but when you look at when you read the source code, it's really, really hard to read. Because the same, you know, things in the same sequence, you know, but they are separated by reception of bytes and whatnot, they are in different subroutines. So you read one single subroutine and go like, what happens after this? Then you have to go to the threading mechanism and find out, you know, what is the next subroutine that is going to call. And then you have to read the code like that, you know, bouncing between the really small, short, fragmented, you know, little subroutines and the threading part, which is a state machine, to figure out, you know, how logic is actually handled. So it's for just for fun, okay? If you have not, you know, read the source code of Squid, it's a fun one to watch, because, you know, how do you get away with a single thread when you have to maintain thousands of connections simultaneously? And because of that, it's also very efficient, because, you know, there's no switching between threads. Unlike, you know, Apache is the opposite, where each connection potentially can start a new thread. So when you have 1,000 connections, you can potentially have 1,000 threads. But the code is so much easier to read because, you know, you just have to keep reading and go like, oh, it's blocking here, and it's continuing, it's blocking again, it's continuing.
as opposed to SWIFT, any time it can potentially block is the end of a subroutine. It just fragments the whole thing so much that it makes the source code very hard to read. So anyway, just little things for you guys to consider when you're, you know, since you mentioned, you know, multi-threading and you've been doing threading before, you know, multi-threading, you know, SWIFT is a prime example of how to do that.
Do we have any assignments outstanding?
Nope, no assignment outstanding, but I do want you guys to think about the project. So,
you want a sequence diagram or?
No, just the use case diagram and the description.
Just use case?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Can
you help me with mic? Yep, I can do that. So let me turn off the recorder, turn off the mic, and I'll see you guys on Wednesday. Today is Wednesday. Next Monday, okay.